SpaceX Starship Updates and Pics, or It Didn't Happen, Rocket Lab's 13th launch. My name is Felix and I am your host for today's episode of What About It. And as always, there has been a lot going on in the space industry lately, so let's dive right in. Starship Updates. Boca Chica, Texas is preparing for the next big event already. SpaceX's Starship serial number 5 is going through the first preparations, maybe even for a launch, and today we'll take a look at what a Starship prototype has to go through after assembly to qualify as a flight candidate. The first hurdle a Starship prototype has to pass before attempting a flight or hop if it's a flight with low altitude is the so-called pressure testing. It's a whole series of tests to make sure the tanks can hold the pressure needed for operation. This first test is divided into two segments, the ambient or room temperature test followed by the dreaded pressure test at cryogenic temperatures. Starship serial number 5 is no different here. After rolling the test stack from the construction site out to the launch site, SpaceX workers, as usual, put it on the test stand, attached fuel lines and thrust simulator, and put it through its paces. The thrust simulator is a large hydraulic press beneath the prototype, pressing against the thrust puck while the tests are conducted to simulate the thrust generated by firing Raptor engines under the Starship as it would be under flight conditions. Serial number 5 passed the ambient pressure test without any problems, and so the Boca Chica crew proceeded to cryogenic temperature testing. The biggest difference between ambient temperature and cryo test is that the nitrogen is cooled down to a temperature of around -200 degrees Celsius. Liquid nitrogen is used as it's inert and thus can be used without the risk of an explosion if a rupture occurs. On a rocket, oxidizer and propellant are loaded at cryogenic temperatures to increase the density. There's one very important factor SpaceX is especially interested in these tests. That's my German accent. Sometimes it comes through. Let's just slice open a Starship and see what's actually on the inside, shall we? Don't worry, no Starship got harmed while filming the episode. On top we have the oxygen tank and on the bottom the methane tank. Both tanks are being tested at ambient and at cryogenic temperatures. Since this is a very shiny looking model, let's see what these parts look like in real life. On the left we have the tank stack with the two main tanks inside. In the middle is the fairing skirt and on the right we have the nose cone. Serial number 5 right now does not have a nose cone or fairing section and most likely won't receive any either. And this is what these parts look like from the inside. Again, we have two main tanks for oxidizer and propellant and a header tank in the middle. The header tank contains the landing propellant. They are separate in order to have greater insulation and minimize boil-off, avoid sloshing on entry and having to pressure up the whole main tank. That's it. I hope this illustration helped you to better understand what's going on inside a Starship. And everything went smoothly during the cryogenic test of Starship serial number 5. Liquid nitrogen was filled into both methane and oxygen tanks and the pressure was brought up. The structure withstood the levels and the prototype showed that it's ready to proceed. The Starship was detanked and this concluded the test activity. Good news for everyone involved.
Yeah.
Next up, after a cryogenic test, a wet dress rehearsal and a series of static fires. This means that a Raptor engine, the full-flow staged combustion methalox engine specially developed for use with Starships and super heavy boosters, has to be mounted on the prototype's thrust puck. And SpaceX had one to spare. Raptor serial number 27 was transported to the construction site late last week and workers began mounting the engine right away. This all seems routine by now as we've been at this point a few times before. Next up, we'll see a Raptor in action. Test dates have already been announced and so in theory we should see some action at the Boca Chica launch site with tomorrow's primary test date and backups on Thursday and Friday. So with a little luck, we'll have the static fire on Friday's episode. As always, a busy week in Boca Chica. Remember the large blue crane from RGV Aerial's footage from the last episode? It's not flat on the ground anymore and so the immense size of this machine becomes apparent. It is gigantic. Right now stretching up around 120 meters into the sky, it is by far the largest crane on site, roughly doubling the large yellow LabPadre crane that is used to lift Starship tank stacks. And while we're busy staring at this huge monster of a crane, let's do a quick size comparison here. The blue crane, to be used to construct the new large super heavy high bay, gives us the first sense of scale for a full Starship stack. So this is how tall a Starship stack on top of a super heavy booster will tower over the launch site. A few meters higher than a Saturn V moon rocket, it will dwarf anything in operation right now. Seeing this, it becomes pretty clear why Elon Musk is already thinking of sea launches for Starships. And remember, even though it's so large, it will be much cheaper to build one and launch than it is right now to launch a Falcon 9. That is the reason why SpaceX is developing this rocket. Fingers crossed they can do this, it would simply be revolutionary. And if you want to get more info about SpaceX's Starship development, details about what exactly they're doing, and lots of other interesting insights into Blue Origin, NASA, Rocket Lab, and many other launch providers and their rockets, I suggest you check out my quickly growing library of episodes. While you're at it, do not forget to hit the like button wherever you see it, and please do subscribe if you have not done so yet. This shows the YouTube algorithm that you actually appreciate my work and in return enables me to make more content for you. Thank you. What Elon Musk and SpaceX are creating in Boca Chica is fascinating and stunning at the same time, and bets have been out for years on when we'll see the first Starship in orbit. The question is really hard to answer, but it is safe to say that the process of getting there is equally exciting as the first orbits. Pics or it didn't happen. Rocket Lab's 13th launch. The second news topic for today goes to Rocket Lab, an incredibly successful story of a launch provider launching out of New Zealand and the United States. This time though, not everything worked as planned. Rocket Lab has been around since 2006, so it can be sorted into the new age of private launch providers in a very similar way as SpaceX. Where SpaceX though entered the arena of medium and heavy launch vehicles, Rocket Lab went for the so-called small sat business. Their carbon fiber Electron rocket is a specialist. Its goal is to provide fast launch cadence at a low price with extremely precise orbit insertions for small sats. With a payload capacity of only up to 225 kilograms to a 500 kilometer sun synchronous orbit, Electron is small, but nonetheless a very sophisticated launch vehicle. And it has performed flawlessly. Until now. Launch number 13, right? Remember Apollo 13? Then the name of the mission, Pics or it didn't happen. It's just too crazy to be true, but yeah, Rocket Lab lost a vehicle. I am not superstitious at all, but this, I mean, come on. There must be something going on here, right? Sitting on the launch pad ready for takeoff with 7 payloads on top, everything looked as, well, every single time before. The customers Canon Electronics, Planet and InSpace mission had, as always, provided more than enough payloads for the fairing to be completely stuffed. High-resolution Earth imaging satellite technology demonstrators, 5 Super Dove constellation satellites manufactured by Planet, operating the world's largest constellation of Earth imaging satellites, and finally a CubeSat from Britain. As always, beautifully presented by Rocket Lab, let's just listen in on this launch.
3, 2, 1.
The Electron rocket took off just fine and went on a nominal trajectory. The 9 Rutherford engines, fueled with RP-1 and LOX and powered by electric turbopumps, have a beautiful sound to them, making these Electron launches a joy to watch. Main engine cutoff and stage separation occurred without any incident, and the upper stage ignited just fine for its burn. The fairing got jettisoned as well, as expected on the mission timeline. At roughly 6 minutes into the flight though, around 20 seconds away from the so-called battery hot swap, a critical part of the mission where the upper stage switches from one battery feeding its turbopump to another, and in the process jettisoning the empty one, the picture feed cut out and the telemetry showed first signs of something being seriously wrong. The upper stage reached a so-called apogee, the highest point of a ballistic curve or orbit. The highest altitude reached was only 194.8 kilometers though, after which the upper stage telemetry showed descending numbers. This should never happen while the rocket normally should still be busy raising its orbit. Thrust went down, the upper stage was not able to further raise its speed and in return its orbit. No Pics anymore either, if you get what I mean. From here on, the speed went further up and the altitude down. As of recording this episode, there is no official cause for the anomaly, but shortly after it occurred, Rocket Lab lost Flight 13 with all its payloads. Peter Beck, the CEO of Rocket Lab, who I already had the honor of interviewing, announced a short statement on Twitter to apologize to the customers involved in the mission. He said that this was the reminder that spaceflight can be very unforgiving. The upper stage followed a safe re-entry corridor, causing no harm to civilians or personnel, and Rocket Lab right now is working closely with the FAA to investigate the anomaly, identify its root cause, and correct any issues to move forward.
As soon as these investigations are complete, and of course all the corrective measures are in place.
It's of course unknown how long these investigations will take and how soon Rocket Lab can get back to business with an improved vehicle. These can be hard times for a launch provider that can take months to go through, so my thoughts are with many Rocket Lab engineers, personnel, and of course Peter Beck himself right now. Keep it up and recover quickly. You rock. After last week's incredible SpaceX GPS 3 livestream, my team and I have many new supporters to thank for an ever-growing community and some very vital funding for the show. This time, special thanks go out to Okay. Andy Hudson, John Randall, Christopher Hovard, Steve Schauer, Florian Behnke, Fred Tice UK, Andrew Brown, Luke Bowers, Graham Gauck, Paul Ware, Roberto Noguera, Howard Walker, Christian Bergmann, Rod Anderson, Brian Moody, Alexander Lemke, Matthew C. Weiss, Gordon C., and many others. You rock! Special thanks, as always, also go out to my team for enabling me to do all this twice a week. Without you guys, this would not be happening. You rock. So this wraps up today's episode of What About It? Will Starship serial number 5 finally do a hop, and is the 13 really a cursed number? As always, tell me in the comments. Yeah.